Welcome, dear listeners, to the Carolina Hates podcast, brought to you by Reek Abbott Productions and A Darker World. I'm your host, Dan Sellers. Bowling Rock is a small town in Watauga County, North Carolina. It was formed in the aftermath of the Civil War. You see, when men would go off to fight in the wars, they wanted to make sure their families were safe back home. Plantations made obvious targets for pillaging and plundering, or worse. So many of those with the means sent their families into the mountains where they were safer. A handful of families sequestered themselves. Some of them were so enamored by the place that they decided to stay after the war was over, establishing the town of Bowling Rock. The area was called Bowling Rock because of the Bowling Rock, a rock formation near the town. It sort of looks as if a wave of rock was frozen just as it was about to spill off the side of the mountain. The formation is embedded with hundreds of zircon crystals. From its height, you can see Hawksbill Mountain, Table Rock, Grandfather Mountain, and Mount Mitchell. But what gives it its name is the near constant wind that blows up over the rock from the Johns River Gorge below. The total difference in height from the bottom of the gorge to the mountain's peak is nearly 1,200 feet. The height of the mountain and the shape of the valley forces wind up the side of the mountain, often amplifying a gentle breeze into a heavy gust. If the wind is strong enough, light items thrown over the edge of the mountain, scarves, papers, even ball caps, can be blown right back up over the edge. But before trying this yourself, be warned, the results can be unpredictable. But it has been well documented that winter storms will snow upside down. There's a Native American legend that surrounds the formation. It goes something like this. Once upon a time, or something to that effect, two tribes lived in the area, the Cherokee and the Chickasaw. They didn't get along and made an effort to stay out of each other's way. When they did cross paths, it always seemed to end in skirmish and bloodshed. Once, long ago, a Chickasaw father and his daughter moved to the Bowling Rock area. Soon after, the daughter was out walking and came across the Bowling Rock formation. She walked up along its height and saw a young brave in the valley far below. She felt compelled to shoot him. Sort of. She playfully shot an arrow in his direction to catch his attention. This strange flirtation must have worked, because it wasn't long before the young brave was courting the maiden. They spent hours walking the trails of the Bowling Rock area, but usually found themselves back at the place where it all started, the Bowling Rock Formation. And if you haven't figured it out by now, the twist is that the young man was from the Cherokee tribe, while the girl, of course, was Chickasaw. One day, while they walked together, the sky began to darken, transitioning through ever-deepening shades of orange, pink, and red. By the time they reached the rock formation, the sky had settled on a blood-red hue. The young Cherokee brave knew what this meant. It was the spirits of the sky telling him that this love he felt for the Chickasaw girl was forbidden, shaming him for neglecting his tribe and his duty. But the heart wants what the heart wants. Torn between his duty to his Cherokee tribe and the love of his life, the brave was forced to make an impossible decision. Unwilling to make a choice, the man leapt off the rocks, plummeting into the gorge below. The girl was heartbroken. She returned to the formation daily, praying to the Great Spirit to bring her love back to her. One day, as she prayed, the sky once again began to darken until it was the familiar blood color of that fateful day. The girl was frozen, terrified. Then the wind began to build, first stirring the leaves, then bending the pine trees lining the clearing. Soon the wind had built into a mighty gale, but the girl remained planted on the spot. Whether frozen stiff with fear or through defiance to the spirits of the air, we'll never know. Then the wind brought something unexpected from the valley below. Her lover floated before her in midair, suspended by the wind. When the spell lifted and the skies returned to normal, the Cherokee brave remained by her side. Hand in hand, the couple stood before both their tribes as a symbol of unity and peace. According to the Native American legend, the wind has remained on the mountaintop from that day forth. Without trying to sound like an infomercial, there are also plenty of interesting things to do around Bowling Rock. Pretty much something for everyone. Of course, there's the usual mountain stuff, hiking, fishing, horseback riding, but other attractions include Mystery Hill, Tweetsie Railroad, Appalachian Ski Mountain, and the Bowling Rock Art and History Museum. Or you can just sit and relax at the Bowling Rock Brewery or one of the nearby historic hotels. The Bowling Rock itself is also available to visit. I was fortunate to be able to go with my family in the summer of 2020. The views are spectacular, and yes, it's a bit windy. From Bowling Rock, we move a little bit further south to Chimney Rock. It's a column of rock in Hickory Nut Gorge that stands over 300 feet tall in the air, looking vaguely phallic from certain angles. But what interests us is that Chimney Rock is home to another legend, even stranger than that of Bowling Rock, the Little People of Hickory Nut Gorge. So if you'll recall our Moon Eye People episode, you'll know that they were highly sensitive to light, averaged about 4 foot tall, and already had an established colony in the North Carolina mountains, long before the Cherokee migrated here a millennia ago. But the Cherokee tell of numerous races living in the region, and several of these species were said to be small of stature, including the Dogwoods, the Laurel People, and the Moonlight People. It isn't clear which species of the Little People of Hickory Nut Gorge may be, but they certainly were not Moonlight People. They were described as being polar opposites. The Moon Eye People were blonde, fair-skinned, and, of course, very sensitive to light. And even though the Cherokee chose to live among them, the Moon Eye People were quite serious and standoffish. When it came right down to it, the Cherokee and the Moon Eye People never really trusted each other. The Little People were dark-haired and half the size of the Moon Eye People. They looked like knee-high replicas of the Cherokee themselves. Like the Cherokee, they grew their hair long. Some had manes as long and as tall as they were. The Little People were jovial and friends of the Cherokee, to a point. They were highly territorial. If anyone passed their border without their permission, including the Cherokee, the Little People would become mischievous. The extent of their vengeance ran the gamut, from playing tricks on the intruder to confuse them, to simply killing them, depending on their mood. But the Cherokee claimed that the Little People would fight alongside them when they went into battle, although no one could verify that because they could also turn themselves invisible. They were said to be very in tune with nature, so it's unclear whether they actually turned invisible or if they were just able to blend into the background, thus becoming unseen to the eyes of man. From these descriptions, they're starting to sound a little bit like leprechauns or hobbits. However, by all accounts, they were more like our traditional rendering of fairies than anything else. Why fairies? Well, because they also could fly. Many of the legends we relate to you on Carolina Haints can be pretty far-fetched, but come on. Foot-and-a-half-tall fairies with invisibility cloaks. Is there any credible evidence for any of this? Actually, there is. Any digging operation in the North Carolina mountains have the potential of unearthing proof of a race of tiny beings. This usually comes during road construction or when excavating a basement. But any digging is prone to finding small tunnels. Small, but too big for an animal to have made, at around 3 foot in size. But there's another feature about these tunnels that rule out animals or naturally occurring features. They're square. The majority of the tunnels seem to have not been used in a really long time, and generally collapse shortly after being found. Bones are also found all throughout the Appalachians. These are not like the formal ceremonial burials of the Cherokee, but random caches of childlike skeletons. Despite being small, the bones show the characteristics of being adult. Bone density and the existence of molars suggest that the tiny skeletons were at least 20 years old. But there's no witness like an eyewitness. And we have that as well. One evening, a man named Robert Searcy was relaxing at home when Elizabeth Morgan, the neighbor's 8-year-old daughter, came pounding on his door saying that she saw someone standing on the top of Chimney Rock. This was 1806. The rock wasn't a climbing spot yet, and the stairs leading up to the park wouldn't be built for another 80 years. At that time, no one had ever been to the top of Chimney Rock. So naturally, Searcy dismissed it as the fantasies of an 8-year-old girl. But then her mother, Patsy, appeared and said something strange was happening at the rock. When he got there, several people were already there. He saw not one person on top of Chimney Rock, but three, and hundreds more flying around the rock. They were all too amazed to turn away. Well, mostly. There was one elderly lady who scoffed at them. She turned away mumbling something about ghosties. "This has all happened before," she said. After about an hour, the flying beings slowly began gathering with the three on top of the rock. Once they were all together, the three that had been standing on the peak the whole time finally took to the air themselves. They led the group straight up through the clouds and out of sight. A few years later, the little people were again seen at Chimney Rock, but this time the situation was different, vastly, strangely different. That's right, the story gets even more weird from here. Locals heard a ringing noise coming from the area of Chimney Rock. A large group gathered to find two armies of little people engaged in a sword battle and mounted on tiny, winged horses. The clash didn't last very long, about 10 minutes. When it was over, the losing army vanished into thin air without a trace, while the winning side gathered together into a formation and slowly rose up out of sight. Through the years, there have been sporadic reports of the little people of Hickory Nut Gorge, but no one knows exactly what they are. Some speculated that they were angels, while others claimed they were aliens. The elders said they were the little people of Cherokee legend, adding that they were in Hickory Nut Gorge long before man set there, and they'll be here long after we're gone. This episode was researched and written by Jeffrey Cochran and was hosted and produced by me, Dan Sellers. You can find everything that Jeff's up to at adarkerworld.com. You can find everything that we're up to at recaptureproductions.com. As always, you can reach me at wreakhavocproductions@gmail.com. We're on Instagram at wreakhavocproductions, and I'm on Twitter at Hank vs. the Undead. You can find this show directly from our feed at carolinahaines.libsyn.com, where you can subscribe on iTunes, Stitcher, Spotify, iHeartRadio, and YouTube. Be on the lookout for the upcoming Carolina Haines book to be published later this year. You can find more details about that and this show at our website, carolinahaines.com. Feel free to like our official Facebook page at facebook.com/carolinahaines. We'll be back in 2 weeks with a new episode. Tune in then to hear more about the things that go bump in the night.